Today we're going to do a quick lesson on VOR navigation. I've had quite a few requests to go over this, so here we are with our VOR simulator, and then we're going to hop into Microsoft Flight Simulator, get into Cessna 152, and demonstrate this working in the airplane so this can all make sense. Now, what is VOR? Well, it stands for Very High Frequency Omnidirectional Range. There are stations that transmit radio beams, or radials we could call them, outward in every direction. Some of them look like this. Let's start with our aeronautical chart. We have a sectional. We have Northeast Florida Regional Airport on it. This is my home airport here. It's a Class Delta, but the VOR does not work at this airport. We're just going to pretend like it does, because on the chart, here is a VOR reference, and the frequency is 109.4. You can see it has VOR and DME, distance measuring equipment. We're not going to worry about the DME part right now. So basically, there's a station here on the ground at the airport, and it's putting out signals in every single direction, and we can tune into that frequency and use our VOR instrument in our airplane to figure out where we are in relation to it and how we can head toward that frequency and head toward that airport. One thing to keep in mind here that a lot of people don't mention is keep thinking the basics of north, south, east, west. You need to figure out if you're north of the airport, south, east, west of the VOR. And that's why we have this zero here, 180.90.270, north, south, east, west. All right, so that's the basic thing to keep in mind, just keep in the back of your head during this. The first thing you're gonna wanna do when you tune into the VOR is you're gonna wanna test and make sure it's working. And when we get in the airplane on the simulator, on Microsoft Flight Simulator, I'll show you how to do that. Here's our instrument. Here's where we are. This is actually showing our position to the VOR. So let's say we've tuned to the VOR, it's working, and this is what our instrument is showing right now. Right now we're heading 130 or so, and this is what the VOR is showing. Let's start by turning our OBS, Omni Bearing Selector, and then right here, this is our CDI, our Course Deviation Indicator. That's this slanted line. And eventually, as we turn the OBS, the Omni Bearing Selector, that slanted line is going to center itself and line up. Still hasn't lined up. Still turning it. Oh, there it goes. Okay, so here we go. Now we're lined up. We know this is to the VOR. If it read from, that would mean that the course that we're pointing to would be what we need to fly to go away from the VOR, but we're going to it. So this is the course that we need to fly to go to the VOR, and we want to keep this line lined up. So as you can see, as you get off course, that needle is going to fluctuate. We want to keep it lined up. So what we're going to want to do is turn the airplane to that heading. We're making a left. We're turning our airplane to 020. As our airplane's turning, our heading indicator's turning. All right, here we go. Now we're lined up. We're on a course of 020. We're on a 020 radial to the VOR, and we're on a 200 radial from the VOR. But all you really need to keep in mind is that you need to head to 020 to get there. We also have to account for wind, though. Because let's say the wind is blowing from the east. We know that we're southwest of the VOR, and we know we need to head 020, but let's say there's a crosswind coming from the east. And as we're making our way there, or making our way to the VOR, we're getting pushed by the wind. We're getting pushed off course. And you see the needle move? And we keep having to line ourselves back up. So what we can do to problem solve this is have a little bit of a course correction here into the wind. You want to crab into the wind. That's going to help you keep that 020 course. So you may actually be pointed 030, but you're moving 020 to account for the wind. And that's something that you can just problem solve as you're flying along. And another thing is, if you get way off course, you know, you just can't figure out, you can't get that needle centered anymore. Just turn the OBS again, and it'll tell you what course you need to fly. So you're like, okay, we've gotten a little bit off course here. Now we need to fly 010 to get to the VOR. Turn to 010, and now you're realigned up with the VOR. The other thing is, as you get closer and closer to the VOR, to the airport, the needle's gonna get more sensitive. So if you're just a tiny bit off as you get closer, it's going to be a lot more sensitive, that needle. And when you're far away, it's a little bit more forgiving. Also, when you finally fly over it, there's a little bit of a dead zone. So the VOR may just drop and stop working for a few seconds, depending on your altitude. It could be longer. And the other way to know that you've reached it is when you, it says from. So we're on two, and if you watch this indicator here and you fly past it, boom, now it's from. And if you want to maintain a heading of 010 as you're flying away from it, then you can use the VOR from to know that you're maintaining 010 away from the VOR. So that's the reason that we have that from. But most of the time, you're going to be using the two. All right, and here we are. We're cruising along in a Cessna 152, maybe a little too far out from the coast. But, you know, ocean or no ocean, we're somewhere in the world, and we want to figure out where the Northeast Florida Regional Airport is and start tracking that VOR. And remember, this VOR, it's not going to tell you everything. You still need to refer to an aeronautical sectional, because it's a combination of using the VOR instrument but also knowing the information on the sectional, because we need to know the frequency, 109.4. We still need to know what the airspace is. It's a class delta. We have the airport diagram, so we know the runways. We know if we want to fly over the airspace, we need to be above 2,500 feet. So this aeronautical chart is very important to use along with the VOR. And we'll go back to the airplane here, and we need to tune to 109.4 to track St. Augustine's VOR. So we'll come over here to the knob. Come over here to the nav receiver. 109.4, and now we have activated it, and boom, did you see that? We'll go back to standby and activate, which means it looks like it's working, but we need to double check that it is working. It's important to know. So you can hit this nav1 button up here, and you're going to be listening for a Morse code, and I do hear it. I don't know if you could hear it, it was a little bit faint, but there is a Morse code happening there, which means that the VOR is active. That's a good sign. If you don't hear anything, then it may not be. Now we can kind of figure out where we're at. So we're going to change the OBS, keep turning it, and now it is lined up, and it's saying we need to fly about 315 or so. So we're going to turn our airplane to a heading of 315. We're going west right now, and we know that we need to go northwest to get to the airport. And you do need to make sure that your heading indicator is matched with your compass. And all we're going to want to do is hold that and just keep an eye on this needle and try to keep that centered. Let's say we, you know, turn too much to the right and we start flying off course. I'll speed up the simulation. I'll go about 4x speed or so. So now you can see over time that needle is starting to drift off. We're getting off course. So we need to turn back. We need to turn back to the left. And then maybe turn back a little right once the needle's getting centered. So it might be a little bit of an S turn to get back on course. It's really that simple, guys. Other than, you know, factoring in winds. But as far as tracking the VOR, it's that simple. You got another one down here. You could get fancy. You could track two VORs at once. And you could use one as a reference to figure out if you're lined up with another VOR. Give you more information about where you're at, because you could compare two VORs on an aeronautical chart here and use them together. So let's say you're tracking another VOR at Gainesville, for example. You're flying along the coast and you have Gainesville tuned in as your second VOR. If you face that omnibearing selector directly west, then you're going to know when you're parallel to the Gainesville Airport, which gives you a better idea of where you are on the map. That's why it's helpful to have two VORs in the airplane. So let's demonstrate this real quick. Let's tune into Gainesville's frequency for our second VOR down here. That's 116.2. Oh, oops, this is just in standby right now. And then we're gonna activate it and activate. So now if you look at this bottom one here, you can see it's active for the Gainesville's VOR. So we've got our OBS here turned directly west. If you see our, you'll see west at the top. And then for St. Augustine, let's line up to St. Augustine because we want to make sure that we're flying toward St. Augustine VOR. So it's indicating that we need to be at about 340 or so to fly towards St. Augustine. So we're going to turn a little bit to that course. And things are looking good. Now, when this needle here for Gainesville gets to the center, that means that we're going to be passing the Gainesville VOR. We're tuned into Gainesville. It's working. It's active. OBS is pointed directly to 270. And as we're passing it, that this needle is going to go to the center. And once it gets to the center, we're going to know that we are passing by that VOR signal. So I'm going to go about 2x speed here, and we'll watch this happen. So watch what this needle does. We're perfectly lined up now. We know that Gainesville is directly to our west now, and we're passing by it. As the needle starts to go the other way, it means that we're passing the Gainesville VOR, headed towards St. Augustine. So pretty cool, the fact that you can use two VORs together like that. That's just an example of what you can do. And then I mentioned you can also use the VOR to line yourself up with the runway. So if we want to line up with runway 31, we can change the OBS to 310. We'll turn a little bit east. So here it goes. It's happening. We're going to slow down the simulation to real time and boom. Now if we turn toward the airport, we're going to be directly on a final for 31. So let's see if we are. Oh, look at that. There's the runway. So let's talk about the ADF navigation real quick. This doesn't have to take long, but just so you're familiar with it, pull up the aeronautical chart here. This is navigation using non-directional radio beacons, also known as NDBs. That's the oldest form of electronic navigation still in regular use. And NDBs kind of diminished with the development of VOR systems in the 1940s, but you could still use ADF equipment and track these NDBs. And if you see this magenta circle, this dotted magenta circle with all these dots, that means that there's an NDB. And then you'll have this rectangle here with a three-digit number, 338. So that's what you can tune this ADF to here in the airplane, 338, 338. And then let's line up our indication here with our heading. We're just going to make this the same as our heading indicator, so it's about 310. And then we need to know that we need to turn to the west to be able to line up with the NDB. And we just want this line to line up straight with our little airplane model here in the middle. And that means that we're flying toward the NDB once it's straight. Let's see if we can get a better view over here. Once it's straight, you could level off. And now we're headed toward the NDB. It's just another means of navigation. And then the last thing we're going to talk about is DME. Coming back to our aeronautical chart here, distance measuring equipment. You'll notice that sometimes instead of VOR, it'll say VOR DME or VORTAC. If it says VORTAC, that means that it has DME, and that's giving you the distance from that VOR. So if your aircraft is equipped with distance measuring equipment, then it's going to give you some information about how far away you are from it, which is really nice, like how many nautical miles you are away. But it is actually a slant range distance. It's showing the distance from your airplane to the VOR. It's not necessarily showing the ground distance below you to the VOR. So just something to keep in mind. So for every 1,000 feet higher you are, then you might want to add about a mile to whatever the indication is. To keep it simple, if you see VOR DME here on a sectional, or you see VORTAC, that means that it does have distance measuring equipment. Now, some of them will not say that. Some of them will just say VOR. Like Cecil over here, it just says VOR. So that means that it probably does not have DME. So yeah, you're most likely going to be using a GPS now because that's how things have progressed, but it's still cool to know the old school ways of navigation, and those instruments are in the airplane, so you're wondering what they are. And hopefully you have a better understanding now. So get out there, fly safe, and I'll talk to you guys soon.